makes you happy?
Yes.
So this makes me happy too. No, I will not be here next Sunday, the 18th, but I will be there. I'll be there like, I'll be back on the 25th. Okay? So somebody else will be here next Sunday. But today you have me, and we're going to fly again. Okay? So welcome to worship. It's a nice day. We had all the rains on Friday, and we survived, didn't we? So we are here to worship, right? Now, before we begin, do we have any announcements? Yes.
Elaine Spalding is home now from rehab. She's one of our long-term members, and she's like visitors. And the good thing is, the dog is no longer an issue for all of you who have a concern about her dog.
Elaine Spalding?
Yes.
Okay, so we should remember her in prayer. Thank you. All right. So now let us just listen to some music.
Thank you.
gracious Lord, who never take a pause from our busy lives and gather here to worship you. Lord, we are not perfect in our ways and actions, but we welcome you here among us in worship. Create in us a new heart and a new soul. We forever embrace it of our fellow men. Restore on us afresh your forgiving nature and your loving heart. Teach us to be more like you in all our ways and actions and every day of our lives. Savior of the world, keep us forever in your care and abandon love. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Our scripture reading comes from the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 3, verses 20 to 22. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice, this is the word of the Lord. So our sermon today is entitled Our Spiritual Report Card. And for those of us who were here last week, we spoke from the book of Ephesians, one of Paul's letters to the church in Ephesus. So the story continues that at the time when Jesus was resurrected and when he went back to heaven from the Mount of Olives, there were about seven churches, Christian churches, at that time. Christianity was more like a criminal act in those days. People were put in jail and they were killed just to be prophesying about Jesus. And today, worldwide, and even here in the United States, we cannot count how many churches, Christian churches, there are, right? There are so many. But in those days, in the early Christian church, we know they were called Christians first in Antioch. We know that, right? And there were seven churches. Why seven? I don't know. Seven is the number of God. We can do the math on that, right? So there were seven early churches, Christian churches in those days. The church in Ephesus, the church in Smyrna, S-M-Y-R-N-A. There was a church in Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia was the place in Rome, and Laodicea. And we know for a fact that if one of us, if you have a business, or if you have three businesses, like three Dunkin' Donuts, let us say for example, one here in Pembroke, one in Rockland, one in Braintree, you would want to keep track of what is going on in those Dunkin' Donuts, right? You know who showed up to work. You know how many hours they work. You know how much money this one makes. You know, you keep track of all your businesses. So we as Christians, when we have churches and we go to church and we pronounce Jesus as head, he keeps track of all the churches who worship his name. And we know that again for a fact, because we know in temple days before there were churches, when Zacharias the priest would go up to until one day when they were praying and they were praying and they were praying for a baby, we know that Zacharias turned around and we saw the angel, and that startled him. You know, if we see angels, we get startled, right? So every church, one more thing, as I said to you, many ministers, they preach from the four gospels, and that's good. That's very good. But that's the milk of the gospel. We've been hearing that for a long time. So we want to elevate our learning. As I said, nobody goes to kindergarten and stays there all their lives, right? We get into a higher class, and then we do it then, and then we go to college, right? So Jesus, now the head of every Christian church in the early days, and he still is the head today, what he did, he said, I'm going to keep an audit. I'm going to watch how they worship me. So every church, he assigns an angel, even to our church here. This is new learning. We have an angel. You can't see it. We could only take it by faith. This is new learning. Because if it shows up, we all going to be running out the door, right? So what he does, he brings the angels in the form of humans. That's what we can identify with. Our human minds are not yet ready to accept the angel marching in here. Come on now. Make the news. So God is smart. So to the seven churches, Jesus assigned an angel. And first to the church in Ephesus, Jesus comes by and he says, I know your works. I know how you toil. I know your patience. I know your endurance. How you detest everything that is evil. But I, Jesus, I have something against you. And that is, you have abandoned for me the first love. When they first became Christians, they had this passion for Jesus. And then it kind of died away. So Jesus is saying to that church in Ephesus, I know your works, but you have denied my first love. He says to them, repent and go back to the way you were first loving me. Then he goes to the church, the second church in Smyrna, and he said, I know your tribulation. I know your poverty. You said you are poor, but you are rich. The devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested because of the days of your days of tribulation. Remember in the early days when they would worship, you know, they could be thrown in jail. But he said to them, be faithful unto death, and I will give you, he will give them a reward, a crown of life. And he said to them, be conquerors. Then he goes to the church, the angel of the church, he's speaking to the angel of the church in Pergamum. Jesus said, I know where you live. You dwell where Satan's throne is. Yes, you hold fast to my name. You did not deny my name, but I, Jesus, I have something against you. In your church, you have some who hold fast the doctrine of Balaam, and they put a stumbling block against my word in Israel. In other words, the story of Balaam, more like a philosopher. Jesus had a little contention with philosophers. Philosophy is the study of knowledge. Some claim to be very smart. And in doing so, they twist the truth of God. So to the church in Pergamum, Jesus said, I know what you're doing. You say you love me, but you study, you lean more to the philosophy of those who claim to be so smart, and they twist my gospel. And we know, most of us, we are aware with philosophers. Some are good, not to be bad, that we know that they're not good. We have Socrates. We think when we're in conversation and we mention Socrates, people might think that we're smart. We have Plato, Aristotle, etc., etc. And Jesus is saying, some of them, they twist my gospel. And calling them back to their first love, come back and worship me the way you used to worship me. Then he goes to the church, he speaks to the angel at the church in Thyatira. Jesus said, I know your works, I know your love and faith and service, patience and endurance, but I have this against you. You tolerated and allowed that woman, Jezebel, who called herself a prophetess, to seduce my servants to practice sexual immorality and to eat the food sacrificed to idols. So I have that against you. Now, ministers don't talk about those things. So you're getting kind of a new knowledge here. When people go to school and study PhD, that's what they learn. So your knowledge is being bumped up here. So he goes to the church in Thyatira and he says, I know what you're doing. You go after Jezebel. This has a little deep with Jezebel. Because she was the center of sexual immorality. And she brought it into the church. And through her, it flowed for years and years. And we know the story. Now, ministers don't want to talk about sexual immorality because they might lose their pulpit. People will throw eggs at their cars. But sometimes we are called, the most times we are called by God to preach the word. The word may not always be the nicest thing to say. Most people don't want to hear that. But if we are called, we have to speak the truth in love. We have to say what it is we were called to do. We have to do what it is we were taught to do. Jesus put us here for a purpose. We have to be eyes, his ears, and his feet in the world. So he's saying to the church in Thyatira, I know what you're doing. You go after Jezebel. I gave her a chance to repent, and she did not repent. So therefore, you have to go back to your first love and preach my word the way it was meant to be preached, not to follow after philosophers or not to follow after Jezebel. Then he goes to church number 5. He's doing an audit. He goes to the angel of the church in Sardis, S-A-R-D-I-S. Jesus said, I know your works. You have the reputation of being alive. You put on a big show in church. But you are dead. You are not preaching my word. Wake up and strengthen what remains and what is about to die. For I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. Remember then what you received and heard. Keep it and repent. Jesus said, you in Sardis, if you will not wake up, I, Jesus, I will come like a thief in the night. You will not know what hour, and I will come. There are some of you in Sardis, you have not messed up, not everybody in the church, you know, it's some really nice people, a lot of nice people in church. Jesus, because he knows our heart, he said, those who have not messed up in Sardis, you will walk with me. I will put on white robes on you, for you are worthy. You have conquered, and I will never scratch your names from my book. I will confess your name before my Father and before his angels. And then he goes to church number 6 in Philadelphia, in Rome. Jesus said, he's going to the angel. He said, I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door, one that you cannot shut. I know that you have little power, but yet you have kept my word, huh? kept his word, and you have not denied my name. And because you have kept my word about patience and endurance, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world to try those who dwell on the earth. Jesus said to the people in Philadelphia, I am coming soon. I am coming soon to you, so hold fast, and I will make you a pillar in my temple. So the church in Philadelphia, they got a fast and break. And finally, he went to church number 7, the church in Laodicea. Now, Laodicea was a city where there were a lot of rich people. Very rich, filthy rich. So Jesus said, I know your works. You are neither hot nor cold. You have a lot of money. So you decide you will come to church, you will not take part in anything, you will just give your money. You are lukewarm, you don't contest any contention. You are just in between. And he said to them, pick a side. You're either a Democrat, a Republican, what else? Independent. You got to pick something. It's worse that you're not picking anything. You got to vote something. So Jesus said to them, pick a side. And then you say you have prospered. I don't need anything. Jesus said, I will speak you out of my mouth because you are wretched. And those are strong words coming from Jesus. He's not making any joke. Jesus said, you are wretched. You said you are rich, but you are poor. You are blind, and you are naked, spiritually. So therefore, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be spiritually rich, and you may wear white garments with me. I will clothe you myself, if you will only repent. And Jesus really liked the church in Laodicea. He said to those who I chastise, I go after them. I want them to change. To those whom I love, I chastise or reprove. So repent and come back to me, the first love. So that was a lot to take in here with the 7 churches. He goes to every church and he gives them their report card. And he tells them exactly what they're doing right, what they're doing wrong. Out of the 7 churches, only one church got a passing grade, the church in Philadelphia. And today we know that there are many churches around. And as I said earlier, Jesus assigned an angel to every church. And if we think that there are not enough angels to go around, we can think again. Because in Revelation chapter 5, if I can get it over here, Jesus is saying, he gives us an account as to how many angels there are. So I'm afraid we may have to do a little math here today. How many of us are good at math? Not too many? So if we can turn, or if you don't want to, I can read it to you. In Revelation chapter 5, verse 11. And I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne of God, and the living creatures, and the elders, and the number of them. And how many angels there are in heaven? I said this is new learning. The number of them was 10,000 times 10,000. So that's how much? 10,000 times 10,000.
100,000.
10,000 times we have 3 zeros, right? 10 times 10,000. I'm going to let you do the math when you go home. But I know we deal with 6 zeros there. So my math could be wrong. Somebody said 100,000. Okay. And then you take that and you multiply that by tens of thousands. You can turn to Revelation 5, verse 11, and see for yourself. So according to my math, I could be wrong. 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. That's about a gazillion. But I could be wrong. But I'm going by thousands with an S, and a thousand is three zeros. And if we say thousands, we don't know. So it goes to infinity. So God has enough angels to go around. And yet, He appoints, He has appointed an angel to this church. This is new learning. We're not in kindergarten anymore. We're up in graduate school now in our church, right? So yes, there's an angel. Every time we worship, the angel comes up. We cannot see it, but it's there. It's taking the minute. Every time we worship or pray, we go up, the angels are watching. They worship it, and they're taking notice. So my question to you today is, out of all the seven churches, how do you think our church here, and I say our church because I'm standing before you, how do you think our church would fare up? Would we get a passing grace? What do you think that Jesus would say to the church, to this church, this morning? Do we even invite Jesus to worship? Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone opens the door, I will come in." And I know we're busy on most Sunday mornings. We do what we do in worship. But He shows up. And He's listening. Many years ago, I was preaching in Halifax. And you know, sometimes when you preach and you preach and you preach, there's nothing left. And I'm just thinking, okay, Jesus, send me a sign, send me something. And nothing came because I thought I preached my life away and there should be a sign or something. I don't know, either Brian, I don't know. And on the last song, the closing song, there was a lady sitting, I think she was sitting on the left-hand side, never seen the lady before. Today she decided she would come to church. She never said a word all through worship. And on the last song, all I heard was an opera singer over there. I'm like, yes! I knew what it was. And I'm saying to myself, you kept quiet all this time. You never sang right to worship. And on the last song, she took it away. And I just zipped it. I knew it was my time. Don't say nothing. And she just carried that song. And everybody was like, woo-hoo. Everybody was, woo-hoo. We never saw the woman again. She met with us in fellowship. And I have not seen this woman up till this day. And we all can say, do you know who that was? We don't know who she was. She was just maybe a lady from the village or from the town or whoever who just came to worship. But there she was. And I'm not saying that to scare you, but it happened. It happened. So the church in Philadelphia is the only church that got a passing grade. Will the church here in Pembroke get a passing grade? And what are some of the things that we are doing wrong and some of the things that we are doing right? Every church that pronounces Jesus as head, Jesus assigns an angel. And most of them, we know that their names end in. Anybody? Most of the angels, their names end in E-L, L. That's what ties them back to God. We have Michael, E-L. He is a warrior angel. We have Gabriel, angel of good news, the Bible only talks about gives us two names, Michael and Gabriel. But we know we have Othiel, we have Ramuel, we have Raphael, and we can go on and on, all in the DL, and there are so many of them. And of course, we have the cherubim and the seraphim. We know who they are, right? Church? Okay. So, they are God in the throne of God. So, to come to the great white throne, that's the security right there. Everywhere we go, sometimes we have to go through security when we travel, right? So, the cherubims and the seraphims, they guard the throne. Jesus is sitting on the throne. You can't just come to him. You've got to go through security. Until when the day comes and he comes to get us, then we can go in boldly. And I'm taking your theology a little higher. I want you to maybe sometime, when you get some time in the week, I just want you to just read Revelation 1 to 3. It is not scary, I promise you. A lot of people think it's scary. But if you only read Revelation 1 to 3, Jesus, and those are the words of Jesus, these are not my words, he gives a blessing to everyone who reads the book of Revelation. I don't know what kind of blessing, it's not for me to know. But even if you don't understand it, just read it. Bless him on it. And Jesus closes the book. He gets the last word. He gets the first word in Genesis. We know him as God. He had not come to earth yet in the person of the Son, Jesus Christ. Right through the Bible, the central theme of the Bible is all about Jesus in the Psalms and everywhere. But he gets the last word in Revelation. And he says, "Behold, I come quickly. If you have an ear to hear, please hear." And then he says, "The words in this book, they are not just, it's not only book. It's not a pie in the sky. Instead, they are faithful and they are true." He reveals himself to us in Revelation. Because as we can read in, it gets a little complicated and we cannot quite understand. But Revelation tells us, Jesus says, "It is me. All what you've been reading through this book is about me. I am the Alpha." Jesus is Alpha Male. You know that, right? No offense. But Jesus is Alpha Male. He said, "I am the Alpha." Not just Alpha. The Alpha and the Omega. It started with me, it's going to end with me. And he said, all we have to do, just take all of this by faith. All the work has been done for us. Early Israel had to keep about 613 laws to pronounce himself holy. Jesus came and he died on the cross for us. And if we can only take that by faith, that's all we have to do. So for many of us who may be struggling with a health issue, family issues, you know, we're humans, we are still present, we still live in this world. Jesus is saying, "Come to me, all of you who are labored and heavy laden, I will give you rest." He doesn't care what you have done in your life before. He doesn't care about your past. He cares about today, this very hour. No sin is too great. Most churches don't even mention the word sin. Can't even say that. No sin is too great that he cannot forgive. A neighbor and a friend, a family member may not forgive you, but he will. And all he's saying is, come. So if you could only, in our hearts, just say, "Jesus, I may not always understand all of what is going on in our world and in the Bible, in religion, but this I do know, that I am a sinner, and today I come to you. I repent of all my sins, and I believe that you are the one who came to this world, who died on the cross, It was buried for 3 days and rose again. Father, please forgive me. And it's that simple. That's the Bible in a nutshell. I always say that. And if you only say that, Jesus immediately, he seals you for eternity. It doesn't matter what happens after that, but once you are sealed forever. And whatever is going on in this world, it doesn't mean that you will never feel another pain, you will never get another flat tire, you will never write a bad check again. We are still humans, we make mistakes, but spiritually, we know that we are sealed. And when our time comes to depart this world, we're in for a great ride. We will see our Savior. And I know I was not sent here just to talk. I will say like Judge Judy, I did not get this job because I'm gorgeous. She says that sometimes, I always laugh. But he knows what he's doing. He's the great counselor, the great commander. And he sends his people wherever he wants them to go. And there may be some who are still wrestling in their faith. Some still doubt if heaven is real. If is not a word in the eyes of God. Yes, it's real. It's a real place. Never mind what the philosophers say, what science, never mind what they say. What we know to those who are spiritually inclined, we know that Jesus is the power of God. And we can all turn to him, we can never get too close, and we just sit at his feet and give it all to him and watch the magic unfold. This is the word of the Lord. We do have a second hymn, hymn number 319. Sing them over again to me. We will sing all three verses. prayer. We pray that you will bless this gift that we offer you. And Father, we know in little you can multiply to make plenty, just as you multiply the loaves and the fish that day. Father, we pray that you can do likewise for us, and that you will continue to bless the giving hands, those who are here, those who are at home. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please do it. And as we come to our moment of confessional prayer, whatever is weighing heavy on your heart, I pray that we can give it all up to God at this moment. So as we take a moment of our thoughts, we look up to the Holy One, and we say, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. Blessed Jesus, hear or hear us when we pray. We pray for our well-being. We pray for peace in our hearts, for our families and our loved ones. We pray for a happiness that seems to be so far-fetched to us, yet it is so real. Father, bring joy to our lives, comfort and healing. We pray that you will descend on us this day, that we can feel your presence. The circumstances that we have experienced for the past week, the past month, and here, our pain, our anxieties, our disappointment, our sadness, and our hopelessness. Father, turn our darkness into day. As you enter our hearts, whisper to us that today is a new day. Behold, all is made well. All is made new. Lavish us with your embrace. Bring a smile to every face. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are ravaged by the aftermath of Hurricane Elsa, and those in Florida from the condo collapse. Father, the gun violence that is in our city, we pray for peace in our land, pray for peace at home. We remember those who are in nursing homes, our doctors and our nurses and our immediate caregivers. We bring those who are disabled, the veterans. We remember the hungry and the homeless always, and all the children of the world, those who still don't know what happiness feels like. Father, we pray today is the day that all will be well, once and forevermore. We pray for good leadership in our church. We pray for a vibrant congregation, one that is eager to hear the word always. And when all else has failed, Father, let us always look up to you. Bless all the children of the world and the grandchildren, the great-grands, the little ones who don't have a voice yet to speak. Father, they are precious in your sight. Let us always be good teachers to the children. And let us now join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. When we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Let us all rise and let us sing triumphantly.